you can imagine them as, for example, some signatures which are strings or text patterns describing a specific attack. This is a rule from PHP-IDS, which is a very popular open source WAF for detecting SQL injections. You can see the regular expression format here. There can be rules which have logical expressions, operators, and conditional variables. These are more flexible than the previous signatures because, except from the content of the trusted input, they also examine other attributes such as the character distribution or the length of the trusted input. Also, they can combine many of the previous signatures. This is a rule from remote security, another popular web application firewall. And they can also be virtual patches or what we call just-in-time patches, which are specific patches for zero-day vulnerabilities that we haven't yet been able to fix them in the code. So we just add a rule to protect our application until the developer team is ready to fix it and make a release, new release. So in order to figure out how difficult it is to find an attack by examining the rules, or generally trying to attack the WAF, if we take all the signatures that the PHP IDS has, which is an open source WAF, and create a state machine with these rules, it will have more than 420,000 states. As you can imagine, this is a huge state machine, Another attribute of the WAF rule sets is that sometimes they are shared between different software. For example, the PHP IDS and Mon Security and Expose framework use all of them use the same rule sets. And they're also being used for log auditing software such as the Atlas software. So the question is, since they are too complex and so huge state machines, why is it possible to find a bypass? Why this bypass exists? And what we are looking for actually? Bypasses can be just simple hacks. For example, sometimes these WAFs have limitations on the size of the input, on the length of the input that the user sends, or on the protocols that they support on the contents. As a result, an attacker can just, for example, add a padding on a payload and create a bypass. This is the simplest approach. Another really fun issue that we found out is that because of this sharing, sometimes things go wrong, very wrong. For example, rules that are shared. For example, PHP, IDS, and Expose share the same rules as I told you before. However, PHP, IDS has this normalization step where single quotes or double quotes or any kind of quotes will be transformed to double quotes. And then, at the rule set matching step, they will have only one rule, one signature, that contains only double quotes. Now imagine what happened with Expose, that they got this rule set, but they forgot to also include the normalization step. We found out that we could bypass this WAF by simply using single quotes instead of double quotes in all the possible attack payloads. Another reason that bypass exists is that some critical components of the WAFs are not updated to the latest version or are not synchronized with the latest release. For example, we found a bypass for non-security for CRS. So we reported it to the guys who maintain the project. The guys start looking and trying to find out why this bypass was possible. And they figured out that they were using a fourth version of a libinject library instead of linking it with the latest version in which the issue was already fixed. So in other products that they were using the same component, the bypass was not possible, but in this product, because they were using an old version, a fourth version, the bypass was still possible. Now, the real fundamental reason is that the signatures will always be insufficient and the root will always be weak. And this is because It is very, very, very difficult to identify an attack without knowing the proper context of the web application and the input that is sent from the user. It is very difficult to create such rules and signatures. So the thing is that you are a pen tester, you have a target, a web application, for example, that is protected behind one of these WAFs, and your task is to detect the vulnerability. What we are going to do in this case? Okay, I think that you all imagine that the first thing that you will do is try to identify the web application firewall and search for known attack vectors. There are tools that will help you to identify the WAF. Most of them use, for example, some artifacts such as cookies and headers that the WAFs leave behind. However, even if you find the attack vectors, if the WAFs are already in the latest version, they will, this attack vector will be fast. Also, can you identify which version are these WAFs? Most of the time, you can't, because the artifacts are common between different versions. For example, all the deployed versions of the WAF will use the same cookie value and the same, will send the same header. So, okay, the next thing that you can do is just gather all the possible attack vectors, create a collection, and try to send all of these payloads and see what will happen. But again, you can't do this. You can't enumerate all the possible payloads. Just let's take one payload, like script, alert, script. How many white spaces are you going to use between the script tag and the alert, word? You have to set a limit here, and this is not possible. Enumerating is like brute forcing all the possible character combinations here. So the third approach, which is what we actually do when we have a similar case in everything, not only in WAFs, is to use a fuzzer. Let's use the AFL, let's use the fuzzer, let's try to create a smarter attack vectors. But the thing is that this also won't work. And the reason is that the fuzzers need a feedback, an input that will tell them if they are doing well or if they are doing wrong with the inputs that they are generating. And since this is a black box test, we just have a target, we don't know anything about this, it's very difficult to provide that feedback. So eventually, for large inputs, it would be like generating completely random strings based on the input that you will give to these fuzzers. 3 days ago, Spider Labs, which maintain more security, announced that they are going to use AFL for quality assurance. So they wanted to use AFL to test mode security, for instance. And they said that they haven't yet managed to use the AFL for the parsing feature of mode security. And it's very important to notice that if they cannot do this easily, while they are doing a white box test, they have mode security, they have compiled with C-Lang features, with debugging symbols with everything, and they cannot do this for the parser of mode security, how a pen tester is going to do this in a black box test? So what we can do, what I propose you to do, is to use LiveLab, which is actually a framework that offers you a novel and efficient way to bypass a web application firewall using automata learning algorithms. LiveLab offers three main things. First of all, it offers you a way to formalize existing knowledge in the code injection and attack variation using automata and context-free grammars. Secondly, it allows you to expand this knowledge using a learning algorithm that will infer the specification of parsers and the targeted WAFs. More precisely, we use the Anduin learning algorithm, the derivation of it, for symbolic automata, actually, that is an active learning algorithm. An active learning algorithm means that it does not learn from a corpus of data, but it queries the targeted WAF at runtime with inputs that the learning algorithm decides. And finally, LiveLab allows you to cross-check the inferred models for finding discovering vulnerabilities. For example, testing for inconsistencies on a model that was inferred. So, about the formalization of the code injection attack, variations using regular expressions and automata. We decided to use automata because this was the most efficient way to create models for the regular expressions, which actually right now the industry standard for text patterns. So all the WAFs that are using text patterns are usually having regular expressions like this. So in order to create models, we transform them to automata, which are small state machines like the one that is presented there. We also use Birabas because they are more efficient for working with. So for example, if we have this SQL injection, a select query, we can create a grammar that will contain all the possible valid suffixes for this SQL injection. And this grammar is not, we didn't create it from the beginning. We just searched the internet, we found an SQL specification for the grammar, and we just port it to work with the select query. Now, Lightbulb comes as a verb extension. You can port it directly to the verb switch framework, that it's the most popular tool for pen testers. It has a list of attack vectors already included that you can select and work with. Let's now examine the following scenario. We have a target WAF, and target the WAF, and we want to bypass the WAF, or the generally the filter that protects our target. We have a very large number of potential non-nexus SQL injections, attack vectors, and we can define them as grammars or regular expressions. Actually, we may do something more clever. We can use the rule sets and the signatures of open source WAF, which already contain models for attack vectors like this, and use them against other targets, since we have access to this, these are open source. So the first algorithm that we will see that Lightbulb supports is GoFA. The main idea of this algorithm is to use the grammar to drive the learning procedure. So as I told you before, Lightbulb uses an active learning algorithm, which performs queries on the targeted WAF. So it performs these queries and it infers a WAF model. Okay? Let's assume that we gave as input an SQL grammar. With this grammar, it created also another model, and now it is ready to do this cross-checking. What it actually does is that it tries to find a payload, a string input, for example, that belongs in the attack vectors model, and it does not belong to the WAF model which was inferred. Because as you can imagine, this could be a bypass for the WAF. We learned what the bypass attempts to block, and we also know have a model about possible bypasses, so we compare these two and we try to find the bypass. It's very simple. So after this, we send the candidate bypass to our the firewall and check if this was actually true or not. It may not be true, because the inferred model may be very small. So in this case, we just, either if this bypass we keep it, we succeed it, we profit, or we just send it as a counter example back to the algorithm in order to refine the model and do the same operation again. So, now, in the Lightbulb extension, how easy is this to implement? First of all, you have to intercept a request with verb from sweep. You just right click on the action button and you forward the request to the Lightbulb framework. Then, you have to select your attack model. As I told you before, Lightbulb has a list of possible attack vectors that are ready to use. Currently, I go to the Learning tab, at the Test sub-tab, and I select the grammar, which is for selecting SQL queries. We also have a Syncs tab, that is just for making the algorithm faster. You can imagine that instead of learning the inferring the targeted WAF model from the beginning, if we assume that, okay, the WAF should be like this, we can also give a seed and make this procedure faster. So then we right click on the forwarded request and select start filter learning. At the end, it will return us a payload that belongs in the attack vectors model that we provided, and it is not blocked by the WAF, the targeted WAF. This is a payload for PHP IDS, however, this is a quite useless payload right now. I mean, you cannot do a lot of things in the SQL, database. So, the problem that arises after this is, okay, MySQL is passing probably a different SQL label than MS SQL. So the grammar list that I created may not be perfect for doing SQL injection. For example, now I got a payload, but it wasn't perfect, okay? I couldn't use it for a direct attack. Browsers are definitely not passing the HTML standard. So even if I create, for example, a grammar for HTML, for JavaScript attacks, or for HTML injections, the browser may not work with this. Or maybe the browser also passes more things than this. So I will lose the extra possible attack vectors. Also, the WAFs are doing much more than a single regular expression matching. As I told you before, they have these extra steps, tokenization, normalization. This will change the model, the inferred model. This will change what actually it is being blocked. So let's re-examine the initial scenario. We have again our target becomes our WAF, but right now we decided the available grammars and regular expressions that we have for creating these attack models are not enough. Are not always good for micro vulnerabilities. What we expect as an attack vector and as a successful vulnerability is something that has no actual sense. It deviates a lot from the HTML standard. But the browser, it's okay for the browser. Internet Explorer will see this as a proper JavaScript or image, for example, time. So what we can do is we can use the second algorithm that is offered by the LiveLab framework, which is SFADIF. The main idea in SFADIF is, okay, if I can use learning algorithm to infer the model of the web application firewall, why not using the same learning algorithm to infer the model that it's accepting from the browser or from whatever is the target that we want to execute the payload? So we do again the same thing. We create two learning algorithms, as is two instances of the learning algorithm, and we try to infer two models. And then we do this cross-checking between these two models. Instead of having our attack vectors here, we learn the attack vectors model this time, directly from the browser. Again, we create candidate bypasses, and if it is a bypass, it's okay, we keep it. If it's not, we just refine our models. You can imagine this bypass that is generated here as a difference between the model that it is blocked by the WAF and it is accepted by the HTML, the browser, for example, the model of that has this HTML model. How you can use it in LiveLab? The approach is again simple. You just use the differential learning tab. You select here, for example, a seed. We propose to you to use the seed because if you use a test in this case and try to learn, for example, using a test vectors from the browser, you may have a very narrow scope on what you have learned. So a seed is better here. And again, you select the start differential learning with browser selection. If you wonder how this looks like, how the LiveLab framework will make requests to your browser and try to infer the model, it is something like this. It will pop up a message saying navigate to localhost, for example, at this port. And when you go there, it will start using querying the browser, using WebSockets, and trying to find, for example, a valid XSS payload. What it actually does here is that it's first the HTML browser model. Finally, on the campaigns, you can see the results, if it is bypassed or not. In this case, for example, we found this bypass for PHP IDS. And also some statistics of the number of the requests that it made to the browser to the WAF, and how many times it did that cross-check. You can see here that it did that 69 times. Okay, the thing is that since we can use straight diff to infer the HTML parser, what else we can do? Why not using to do this with browser filter? For example, the XSS auditor of Chrome. Or why not using it for SQL parser, like MySQL? Lightbox support both of them. There are selections that will allow you to do the same procedure, for example with MySQL, and try to find a valid SQL injection that bypasses the WAF and it also accepts it from the MySQL server. Okay, then, since we can get a difference between these two models, why not using it to generate fingerprints between applications such as the two WAFs and be able to distinguish the WAFs? Again, we do the same approach, we just change the browser to a second WAF, and the bypass that we get is now just a difference. I mean a payload that one WAF will accept and one WAF will block. Let's take the following scenario. We have this in this black box a WAF that we cannot identify. We don't know which is this WAF. And we have a number of known WAFs. Okay? The question is, which of these is in the black box? We use the offered algorithm for LightBulb framework to create differences between the first two WAFs. We test the difference, and depending on the answer, if it is blocked or if it is accepted, we exclude one of these two. And then we continue doing the same binary tree searching approach until we end up with only one WAF. And this WAF will be the one that it is probably in the black box and we were asking for it. By doing this, you can also create a binary tree like this with payloads that one WAF accepts and one WAF rejects. So this can also be created offline. You create this once and when you have to identify a WAF, you use these payloads. Like the LightBulb framework has already a list of generated trees that you can directly use. For example, you select the tree from the panel and you select start filter WAF distinguish. But okay, since we can do this, why not generating your own fingerprint trees? The approach is simple again. You just forward more than one HTTP request to LightBulb framework. For example, one request for PHP IDS, one for expose, one for security. You select all of them and you select start filter distinguishing tree generation. And it will create one such tree for you. And okay, since we can create fingerprints for WAFs, what else we can do? We can also do this for browser fingerprinting. The framework supports the ability to do the exactly same approach, but now for the browser models. So it can generate, for example, a payload, like a JavaScript payload or an HTML payload, that one browser will understand and will parse as valid HTML, and another won't. So you can use this payload, for example, to distinguish visiting users in your site, using the parsing language of the browser that the user is currently using. Now, we've found some other abilities using the tool. For example, using this grammar, which extends the search conditions in an SQL query, we found the OrExist select one payload. That can be used for bypassing authentication queries. This is a very common query for web applications. They receive two inputs, a username and a password from the user, and they try to query the database to see if it exists or not as a row. So using the payload, we can create a query that is always true. And this affects very popular web application firewalls such as both security, PHP, IDS, webcast element expose. And yet another authentication query, it's almost the same. We can use it in the same condition, and it's one array is equal to one. So instead of a, you have to use just a valid variable or a column name from the database. For example, here I guess that it's probably is admin or admin or something like this or ID. So I can use this and circumvent PHP IDS. Also, we found other payloads that can be used, for example, to fingerprint existing columns or variables in the database. We found that NXC select A or A greater than any select A can be used, for example, for this purpose. We want, for example, to fingerprint if the email column exists in the database schema, and we extend the query like this. The file, the WAF won't discover this attack, but actually won't identify this attack. And we can easily fingerprint bit by bit, for example, the column names. Then we use another grammar that extends the select queries, the same with the one that I showed you before. And we found, for example, this data retrieval bypass, the join query. So if a web application, for example, combines two tables, let's imagine that it is a web application for authors and articles, and it wants to create a query that will retrieve the data from both tables, we can extend this query with the right join, and retrieve also the data from the user's table, like the user password. This also was a bypass for both security and web Castellum. Again, a group by a ask, which can be used for fingerprinting variables and column names. And the procedure A, which, for example, can be used as procedure analyze to get inner workings of the database schema. This affected the leap injection component. Using SFAD, we found the vulnerabilities like the one that I showed you before. About the other event handlers. Set for PHP IDS and Expose framework. If you check the rules, the signatures that PHP IDS has, you will notice that the rules 71, 27, and 65 are trying to mitigate the risk for these attacks successfully. They have some slight variation of what they accept and what they don't. So if you use other symbols, it will probably not be attacked. But if you use these symbols, it's okay for them. So future work. Currently, we are working on many, building many optimizations for the LiveBulb framework. We initially made LiveBulb for research purposes, so we have some code that is not the most efficient code, and we are trying to improve it. We are also have a similar line of work for sanitizers. Sanitizers is a totally different thing. For example, it can be a simple code like HTML encoder on URL encoding. And yes, you can use LiveBulb to emulate the same attack, but it is not the best that you can do. So we are working on learning algorithms that will also be able to cover more specific cases and perform better, have a better learning approach on these things. Also, another thing that we are working on is that we try to incorporate fuzzers to improve the attack models. Instead of letting the user to decide which models he wants to use, which attack vectors he wants to use, we want to leave the fuzzers to do this decision, take this decision. Generally, our vision is to try to enforce the standard for such products. Try to enforce a way or a method that the pen testers will follow each time they want to do an audit in a protected target, a target that is behind one of these WAFs. Also, we are open to contributions. If anyone wants to contribute, has an idea, and wants to develop the idea, he is very welcome. So thank you. You can find LiveBulb at this URL. If you have any questions.